Okay, so you've built yourself a dashboard, but nobody's actually using it. What did you do wrong? Where could you do better? Now, the reality is, building an effective dashboard is not just about putting data onto a canvas. How can you get people to actually then use it? In this video, we have a clip from our Measure Masters live training we've done with Andreea Popa from KPI Studios. She taught our Measure Masters how they can enhance their Data Studio dashboards with a few simple steps. And this training was so well received that we wanted to share it with the Measure School audience as well. But before we get started, as mentioned, this has been taken from our Measure Masters live training, which we do every month inside of our membership, where you will be also able to access courses, a community, and a support system helping you to succeed with data. If that sounds interesting to you, then check us out at measureschool.com/measuremasters. And with that out of the way, Andreea, take it away.
So why should you help your clients understand their data? Why wouldn't you just give them a crowded dashboard and let them figure the data themselves? I'm not a huge fan of quotes, but I really resonated with this one here. The idea is that in the end, if you help your clients do this, you will give them meaning. So they will learn to start going beyond just collecting the data, and they will see the value of it. They will start applying it to their business and growing their business based on it, making better business decisions, knowing where to invest, where to not invest, where to allocate the efforts and where not. You will also save them considerable amounts of time, and they will definitely be grateful for that. Also, don't forget about the fact that if you don't overwhelm them with a dashboard that from where they don't understand anything, but from one that is clean and gives them more insights than just pure data, they will see your service's value and they will want to return for further help. That's the bottom line. Enhancement number 3, add time series annotations. For your clients that are used to add annotations in Google Analytics, or the ones that have questions about the spikes and the dips in traffic, you can create an annotation system in Google Data Studio 2 using data blending. And you can see here that I have page views and notes, and this time series contains 3 notes. So your clients can see all the notes at once, or can just click on one of the annotations and see exactly what event was recorded on that day. So in this case, on June the 1st, we started the International Children's Day campaign and we ran paid advertising on Facebook. So this is what caused the spike in the next days and probably the dip that comes after pausing a campaign. Like I said, you are going to use data blending. In our case, it's the Google Analytics data source. And for the annotations, we are going to use a Google spreadsheet and add all the notes that we want. In this case, we will use as a dimension the dashboard annotations because it's text and it is recognized as a dimension. And we will add a column with a date so that we use the data blending with the join keys of date. But what's important is that at the chart level, we will use both the page views, so the metric, the KPI, the KPI that you chose, and the dashboard annotations. We will use them as metrics. As you can see, the notes are counted here. So you will add the notes as a metric and they will be automatically counted as an aggregation. Also, make sure that the page views are, you set them up as a line or whatever metric you choose. You set them as a line and assign them to the left axis, and the notes, you mark them as bars, and then you assign them the right axis. And that's it. You have the time series annotations that is lacking in Google Data Studio, but there's a workaround for it. Enhancement number 4, group and simplify with case when formulas. Case when formulas are probably my favorite function in Data Studio. For this tip, I'm going to give you two examples. One is for simplifying the organic position and customizing it, putting in it into ranges. And the other one is for traffic channels. So in this example here, I will reselect everything. And we have the average position, which you can see it's all over the place. And we have these position ranges. The position range is this case one formula here that, by the way, is clickable and you can go and copy it and adapt it to your needs. And I will show you how this functions. So let's say your client wants to focus on the keywords that are between 11 and 20 in organic that have these positions, and they can select these and analyze them. I cover them, yes, analyze them, and I don't know, do something about it. And you will see that we have the position range here. So yeah, instead of scrolling through hundreds of, or I don't know, if they want to reach, for example, keywords that are on position 30, instead of scrolling all the way to there, they can just select this more than 30 and get there directly. There is an intermediary step here. It's a formula for rounding the position and also a data blending involved, but we can discuss this afterwards if you have the question, that if you want to see more in depth how this is done. Okay, then the traffic channels grouping. Let's start with the traffic channel grouping in Google Analytics. So if you worked with the traffic channel grouping there, you probably know that it's really strict, and if you it's easy to mess up with it, and if you make any changes, it will affect how you grouped all the traffic, and it's also not looking at historical data, and how it has a lot of disadvantages. In my opinion, Data Studio is much better for this channel grouping because it's instant. It rearranges, reshuffles the traffic as you want and puts it in the correct channel if you made any mistakes, and then you will have the accurate data instantly, unlike Google Analytics, where if you make any mistake, you cannot know for sure if the data you are looking at is correct. Okay, so in this case, for this client, it's not a super complex formula, but it's just an example. So instead of paid search, they can look at paid search for branded and non-branded. Instead of email, they can look at email newsletter and email with offers. Instead of social, they can look at a social paid and social organic, and the possibilities are endless. And yes, you will reach a super complex formula. It can get much longer than this. But like I said, you will be sure that the client has the correct data, the data that they can rely on, and the data they can use to grow their business, especially since you want to know maybe where to invest more money and where to invest less effort and money. My final enhancement recommendation is to use monthly forecasts. You can build simple predictions to see how your budget will look like at the end of the month and what is the remaining budget per day. Also, this is a good chance for you to think about, is it a good thing that I'll be 23% under the budget? Is it a green zone, or is it maybe yellow zone, or even red one? There are a lot of clients that want all their budget spent so that they can have a high return on investment. How will you do this? So in this case, we have the total monthly budget in a separate data source, a Google spreadsheet data source, and we're blending it with, let's say, a Facebook ads data source. The budget remaining this month is a simple calculation between the monthly budget and the amount spent. But don't forget, it's a data blend. for the budget remaining per day, the calculations are a bit more complex, so to say. Don't forget again that you can click on all of these and you can copy the formulas and adapt them to your needs. So feel free to do that. Okay, so step one is extracting the month from your date and then calculating how many days there are in a month with a case when formula. And then we want to calculate how many days passed this month and how many days are remaining this month. So after we have all these, it's simple. We have all the fields that we need to calculate the budget remaining per day. And then for the end of month forecast, we will need these steps. So we have the amount spent and we will multiply them by the days passed this month, which means that we will get an average per day. And then we will multiply it by the days in the month, which means that we will have a prediction for the total month based on what happened until now. It doesn't mean that there won't be fluctuations, but remember that we will get an update every day. And then we divide it by the monthly budget. Because it's a percentage, we will also need a minus one there. And this is what we get. We get the at the end of the month, we will be minus 23 under the budget. For the under over the budget here, this is a table like we used in the first enhancement. And for this one, I recommend that you're using it at the chart level only, because you will get this error message, but it will work. So why not take advantage of it? Also, don't forget to conditional format these values. Not necessarily, but it's better, it's easier for your client to quickly understand what's going on and define them with the colors that you think are right for your situation. And this is it for the monthly forecasts. Thank you.
Thank you, Andreea, for these amazing tips. That was not all. Shared other interesting visualization tips to enhance your Data Studio dashboards in the live training. So if you want to check that out, head over to measureschool.com/measuremasters and maybe I'll see you in the next live training right there. Now, my name is Julian. Till next time.